An often cited argument against the existence of Dyson swarms is that a civilization will have no need of one once they harness fusion technology. Dyson swarms are not shells, they are constellations of satellites in direct orbit of something that have various functions ranging from habitats, as Dyson himself suggested, to energy collectors. Dyson swarms are eminently possible and do not suffer from the mechanical or engineering issues associated with full-on encasing Dyson shells, which are often called Dyson spheres. But Dyson's idea was actually much more generic than that and could have meant anything. We have already built multiple Dyson swarms. We have a classic solar one, in the form of our array of active and dead probes, usually solar-powered, that directly orbit the sun. These only grow in number as we develop that swarm because we almost never return spacecraft to Earth. It's not worth it in this case. And we leave them to orbit the sun in a defunct manner for the next billion years or so. As I covered in a previous video, eventually the number of these glowing in infrared from absorbing the sun's radiation grows to such a number that it becomes visible to aliens at a distance. But we also build such swarms around planets, though we usually do not term them as planetary Dyson swarms. They are constellations of satellites, such as Starlink, which now has over 5,000 satellites in orbit. These are proof of concept of a Dyson swarm and stand as a testament that aliens probably do build them, because we do, and they are frankly useful on many fronts to the point that we should be looking for them at SETI. And that's not just anthropocentrism, but rather free energy is free energy, and space travel is space travel. If aliens have even more superior technology than that, and there are many things left we don't know, and they could be tapping into energy sources we are currently unaware of, but there's no way to know how to detect that from our perspective, so they may as well not exist, because we don't possess the knowledge to find them. And while a good argument, it's also important to remember that it stems from Arthur C. Clarke. Any sufficiently advanced alien technology is indistinguishable from magic, but we don't see that. We do not search the heavens and find unambiguous technosignatures that appear as magic. Rather, we see a great silence. So, in apologies to Arthur Clarke, I'm coming along half a century later, and I would revise this. Any sufficiently advanced technology is apparently indistinguishable from nature, and so far we've seen nothing convincing going on that appears to be magic. Rather, we just see a whole lot of nature, an ambiguity in anything weird and interesting. But we know it's ambiguous. It's not doing anything magical in appearance. But why would an alien civilization actually go through the trouble of building a Dyson swarm when they can have fusion energy? The answer is very simple. If you pursue fusion energy, you still end up with a Dyson swarm. And it's one, less efficient, less ideal than what you could alternatively have with a solar swarm. In my recent video, I detailed that you might end up with a detectable Dyson swarm just out of the interests of population pressure. If you exceed the carrying capacity of Earth, and now I'm not by any means a Malthusian alarmist, but if we end up with 100 trillion humans living on Earth, no matter what you do, you're going to run out of sheer surface area. That leaves you with going to space and building habitats, new land. It's that simple. You have to colonize other planets or build space habitats, because if you don't, your planet is going to correct and limit you. So you're stuck with that as long as your population continues to increase. Though an argument can very easily be made that populations don't increase indefinitely, and it's valid. Make having one offspring expensive, undesirable, unneeded, or you're so rich you don't need more than one kid and you're in a different boat. But aliens may not have that option, in that we can choose to reproduce or not reproduce. Aliens biologically might not be able to choose, and reproduction at exponential rates happens no matter what. If your offspring, for example, comes from getting cut in half as a worm can do, then you're also going to reproduce no matter what. Or if you naturally clone, like some plants, or if you no longer naturally reproduce at all and have gone fully artificial with cloning, then you can have as high a population as you want. Or even if you divide like a cell, though that one would be tough to pull off with a complex organism with intelligence. Or if you've gone technological, and you find it's a good thing to have more and more android members of your civilization around, which is going to require a lot of energy. And that brings up humanity's current trends. So we really are facing a very real but not widely known reality. We are consuming increasing amounts of energy dedicated to computation and information storage. It does not seem likely that without some catastrophe that makes us less likely to stop our growth and energy consumption, that this situation will change. It's going to keep growing, and it's possible that the motivation of storage and computation never stops growing, which drives a civilization to progress through the Kardashev scale. And that's where we get to the pitfall of fusion energy. Fusion is unbelievably promising, but only in the context of our energy needs as they are now. We are still using things like fossil fuels and geothermal and wind, underusing nuclear fission and so on, but fusion solves most of the problems of all of those, if you can build the infrastructure to support it. This seems possible, but as is often pointed out, fusion energy is always 20 years away. I do not think at this point it is. I think enough progress has been made to say that we're going to have it in 50 years, and there could easily be wild cards where we get it much earlier, but it actually at some point becomes a limiting technology. Fusion energy will someday go obsolete. And here's why. You have to fuel it. It's that simple. On Earth, you have options for that, and they will take us a long way at our stage of development. But if we continue to demand more and more energy for computation, then it's going to hit a limit. Once we exhaust Earth's fuel sources and the moon's resources, then we're going to run low on fuel. This is many hundreds of thousands of years into the future, of course, but it does reach an end. And that puts you up against a reality. By far, and really by far, the most abundant source of fuel for fusion power in your star system is your star. Most of the mass in the solar system is concentrated into the sun. Yes, you can mine Jupiter and Saturn, but the holy grail of easy fusion fuel is the sun. It's a huge ball of fuel that would take so long to exhaust that it's mind-boggling. Even on its own, it has enough fuel to keep going for another 4.5 billion years. And even after it's done for, its cooling period as a white dwarf will be even longer. It's the energy source for the solar system for a very long time to come. Well, the bottom line is this. If you have to stellar lift material from your star for fuel for fusion energy, then you have just built a Dyson Swarm in the form of those collectors needed to mine your star. There actually are ideas out there, really proto-ideas, on how to detect stellar lifting for fusion energy as an alien technosignature. Because, well, develop fusion all you want, it still requires fuel. That means it's a good candidate for common ground with alien civilizations. But in the case of a Dyson Swarm, you don't need fuel other than to build it. No gas is needed to fill the tank because your star is already fully fueled and fusing on a level that you'll never get to with your own fusion unless you build an artificial star. You've got 170,000 terawatts streaming off a star like the sun, for free, no fuel needed, that all you have to do is harvest. With fusion, you have to mine the fuel, get the reaction going, and go through a much more expensive process to make it work. That really only makes sense situationally in the far future. Situationally, by that I mean us. It makes sense for us right now to develop fusion. Because it's also easier to pursue right now than it is to build a bigger Dyson Swarm than the one we have. But when we do get to that level where we can do that, then fusion becomes situational. It's something for deep space probes and environments where there isn't much access to strong solar energy. This fusion will someday become an archaic legacy technology, perhaps something like a vacuum tube. Those have their uses in things like guitar amplifiers because they sound good, but we no longer run radios and televisions on tubes. It's going to be the same thing for fusion. It will probably always have its specialized uses, but will stop being a global power source at some point because mega-scale solar in the form of a Dyson Swarm is the better, easier, more straightforward idea. Again, assuming that our energy needs will someday reach the level of the output of a star, a Kardashev Type 2 civilization. If we don't, and at some point energy use plateaus and we never really extensively colonize space, then fusion will remain the best option more long term. But it pays to remember, stars still run on fusion, and it's of a type we can't replicate without building an outright star. The internal pressures in fusion processes just dwarf almost anything we could do with technological fusion reactors. So no matter what you do, fusion seems to be the key to all energy. And it could be said that it's powering the universe, and it's really something we look to harness rather than invent. But there is always a wild card here. We know that there are forms of energy in the universe that we suspect exist, dark energy being one of them, that we know absolutely nothing about. We have no idea what the details and rules of it are, nor do we know if that kind of energy can be harnessed. If that's the case, and it can be, then we and any advanced alien civilizations out there will stop using fusion altogether, natural or artificial, and progress to something currently unforeseen. Perhaps dark energy is currently indistinguishable from magic. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently on a kick exploring the ideas of Freeman Dyson. Wait until I get to the Astro Chicken in a coming video, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.